Hello students, welcome to Engineering Geology classes. In today's class, we will discuss the one more geological structure, that is joints. So in the image, you can see there is a exposure of the rock, that is the outcrop, wherein you can see the presence of cracks on it. So the rock is showing the cracks on it. So those cracks or the fractures, they are called as the joints. So let us begin with the definition of joints, its types and classification. So here the definition of joints is, the joints are defined as the fractures or cracks in the bodies of the rock along which there has been no relative movement or displacement. So here the difference between the fault and the joint is what? So in fault, we have seen how the fault take place. There will be a formation of cracks on and on either side of these crack, the rock blocks, they undergo a relative displacement. So this is also a crack along which there is a movement of the rock, that is we call it as fault. But here in joints, there is no displacement of the blocks, only the formation of cracks will be there. So that is called as the joint. So joints are the cracks or the fractures in the bodies of the rocks along which there has been no relative displacement. If there is a displacement, then it is called as a fault. Okay, so most of the joints are plain and some are curved surfaces also. So these divide the rocks into two parts or blocks, and unlike fault, in fault what happens, the blocks are moved past each other, but here in joints only the crack is formed. There is no movement of the rock blocks on either side except the slight opening in some cases. So there are openings or cracks in the rocks, except that there is no relative movement. If there is a movement along the crack, we call it as a fault. So that is the difference between a joint and a fault. So joints may be open or closed. So they may be open or they may be closed type. So when the rock masses, they are subjected to tensional, compressional forces, then the regular or irregular fractures develop in them, and such fractures, they are called as the joints. So these joints are formed as a result of the tensional and compressional forces which are acting on the rock. Okay, so these joints, they may be varying in the length, okay, from few meters or few feet to hundreds of feet together, these joints can occur. So the distance between them is measured even in feet or tens of feet. Okay, so they may be very close to each other also, or they may be very far apart from each other. So these joints, they have the attitude, that is dip and strike. Okay, like the rocks, we have studied the dip and strike. So most of the joints, they are smooth. Okay, but some, they show markings such as depressions or ridges. So these are the common structures which are associated with joints. So these are formed when the rocks are subjected to tensional or the compressional forces. Okay, then the joints are formed. So these, as a civil engineer, the knowledge of joints is very, very important, because these are the cracks, these are the fractures. So whenever you deal with any type of project, you must have a better understand what type of joint it is and how it will affect the civil engineering structure. So these joints, they are formed in all types of rocks. You will get joints in igneous rocks also, in sedimentary, and even in metamorphic rocks, we will find the rocks. So, the joints. Okay. So the joints which are formed during the formation of rocks, then they are called as primary joints. Okay, like the columnar structure you have seen. In that, while cooling of the lava, the contraction takes place and the cracks are formed. That is called as the columnar joint. So such joints which are formed during the formation of rock are called as primary joints. Okay, and some joints they can be traced over an extensive area, okay, over a larger area, then they are called as master joints. And these play a very important role because they control the percolation of water, and even you can determine the water supply based on the presence of joints. So these joints are very, very important from civil engineering point of view. Now let us discuss how these joints are classified. So the joints are generally classified in two ways. One is geometric classification and other one is genetic classification. So the joints are classified geometrically and genetically. So what is mean by geometric classification? So this classification is based on the relation with the attitude of the rocks in which the joints occur. So here the rock is present. Suppose this rock is inclined, then it will have the dip and strike. So with respect to the dip and strike of the rock, how is the joint? Based on that, there are different types, and that is called as the geometric classification. Then genetic classification is based on what is the cause for the origin or formation of that joint. Based on that, there are different types of joints. They are called as genetic classification. So let us discuss the geometric and genetic classification of joints. So here is the geometric classification of joints. So I told you what the geometric classification is. What it is, based on the relation with the attitude of the rocks in which the joints occur. So here you can see two diagrams to make you understand. Okay, so here there is a bed, okay, which is dipping in this direction. Okay, so if this is the dip direction, this will be the strike of the bed. Okay, same way here also I have given one bed whose dip direction is this way. Okay, so this is the dip, then this is the strike of the bed. Okay, first let us understand this concept, then you will go for the classification of joints. Okay, so first we'll see what is the dip and strike of the bed. Okay, so here this is the dip of the bed and this is the strike of the bed. Similarly here, this is the dip of the bed and this is the strike direction of the bed. Okay, so what is dip and strike? The angle of inclination of a bed with respect to horizontal plane, that is a dip. And strike is what? A strike is the direction of the line which is formed by intersection of the bedding plane and the horizontal plane. So that is called as the dip and strike of the bed. Okay, so here this is the dip and strike of the bed. Now let us discuss about the joints. With respect to this, we will classify the joints now. So here the first type of joint is the dip joint. So what is dip joint? So these are the joints, or those joints in which the strike of the joint is perpendicular to the strike of the bed. Or in simple way, the dip joint is one. You can see this is the crack which is shown as the dip joint. So how you can see clearly, it is running parallel to the dip of the bed. This joint is running parallel to the dip of the bed. Similarly here, ABC is the dip joint. So where is ABC? okay, it is running parallel to the dip of the bed. So this is the dip of the bed and this is the joint which is running parallel to the dip direction of the bed. So here dip joint is what? The joint in which the dip of the joint is parallel to the dip of the bed, then it is called as the dip joint. Then let us discuss what is the strike joint. So strike joint are those that strike parallel or they are essentially parallel to the strike of the bed. So here you can see this is the strike of the bed and this is the joint which is running parallel to the strike of the bed. Then it is called as the strike joint. Okay, so strike joint is what? The joint which is parallel to the strike of the bed. Okay, so this is the bed and this is the strike of the bed, and this joint which is formed in this direction, that is parallel to the strike of the bed, so it is called as the strike joint. So here this is the strike of the bed and MNO is the strike joint which is parallel to the strike of the bed. Okay, then next is oblique joint. Okay, oblique joint is what? It is neither parallel to the strike nor parallel to the dip of the bed. It is running oblique. So here you can see this is the dip and this is the strike of the bed. But this particular joint, okay, how it is moving? It is neither parallel to the strike nor parallel to the dip. It is running oblique. So it is called as the oblique joint. So here in this image PQR, okay, and STU, they are running oblique to the dip and strike of the bed. So they are, that is called as the oblique joint. Okay, then the last one is bedding joint, which is parallel to the bed. Okay, so this is the bed and this particular joint which is running parallel to the bed. So bedding joints that runs parallel to the bedding planes of the rock, so that is called as the bedding joint. Okay, that is JKL is the bedding joint, then PQR and STU, they are the diagonal or oblique joints. So here these are the diagonal joints which are running neither parallel to the strike nor parallel to the dip of the bed. So here this classification is based on the relation of the bed and the relation of the joints. Okay, so this is the classification which is called as the geometric classification of joints. Okay, then we'll move on to genetic classification. So depending on the cause of their origin, the joints may be divided into the tension joint. Here you can see this rock is under tension. This is the stress which is acting on the rock, and here because of that the rock has folded, and you can see there are cracks which are formed as a result of bending. So these joints which are formed as a result of tensional forces acting on it, they are called as tension joints. So let us discuss the genetic classification of joints. So the tension joints, what are those? Those are the tension joints are those which are formed due to operation of tensional forces which are produced in the rocks either during or after the formation of the rock. So that is called as the tension joint which are formed as a result of tensional forces acting on the rock. Then the second type of joint in this is shear joint. So shear joints, they are formed by shearing stress, or you can call it as a compressional force which is involved in the folding and faulting of the rocks. So joints developed in the limbs of the fold, they are called as the shear joints. So here the joints which are formed at the crest, where the tension is maximum during folding of the rock, right? Such joints are called as tension joints. And the cracks which are formed at on the limbs of the fold, they are called as the shear joints. Okay, so these are because of the compressional forces acting on the rock. So here you can see the shear joints. Okay, there is a formation of cracks, and the cracks which are formed here because of the shearing stress, they are called as the shear joints. So these are tension joints and these are shear joints. So this is the classification of genetic classification, that is the forces which are involved in the joints are either tension or compression. So tension joints and shear joints. So we'll discuss the different types of tension joints. So tension joints or fractures, they are of different types based on the formations. Okay, so the first type in the tension joint is the columnar joint, which we have discussed during igneous rocks, right? So these are the joints which are developed in volcanic igneous rocks. So volcanic igneous rocks, how they are formed? When the magma comes out on the surface through the volcanic eruption and it starts flowing on the surface of the earth, that is the lava flow, right? And such lava, when it starts cooling, the rock, the common rock formed by lava flow is the basalt. Okay, so these are produced due to intersection of two or more set of vertical joints within the affected rock mass. As a result, the country rock which is there, that splits up into number of vertical columns in the plane. Okay, that may be rhombic or triangular or hexagonal or even polygonal in shape. So such joints, they are the result of cooling and contraction of the homogeneous magma. Okay, so the basalt, it solidifies around 1000 degrees Celsius and it slowly cools down, and during its cooling, what happens? It starts contracting towards the center, as shown here in the image. You can see the centers of contraction. Okay, so towards this portion, they are equally spaced centers of contraction, and because of that, the cracks are formed here like this. Okay, so they may be polygonal, hexagonal, pentagonal in shape. So here you can see, right, the columns, beautiful columns which are formed as a result of cooling of magma. This is the Devil's Hill wherein you can see the whole, it is like a volcanic neck. Okay, wherein the lava has cooled, resulting into formation of columnar structure or columnar joints. Okay, so the resulting tensional forces, they act in a horizontal plane and in equal in all direction, and that is how the columnar joints are formed. So in India, if you want to see the columnar joints, the best place where it is exposed is the St. Mary's Island in Udupi. Okay, it is also called as Malpe Island. So there you will find such type of columnar joint. The whole island is made up of such type of columnar rocks. Okay. So here in Belgaum also you can see at few places, because we have the basaltic rocks here. So in Maharashtra also we have such formations of columnar joints. Okay, then the next type of tension joint is the sheet joint, or it is called as sheeting joint. So these are the horizontal joints. You can see they are horizontal joints. Yes, so they are the horizontal lines. You can see the lines, okay, they are horizontal, okay. And these joints, they are developed in massive igneous rocks like granite, and they are best exposed in the openings in the quarries, okay. So how these are formed? These the sheeting surfaces, they are somewhat curved, and they are essentially parallel to the topography of that particular area. So they are parallel to the topographic surface of that area. So they are closely spaced in the upper layer, okay. In the upper layer, they are very close to each other, and as you go deeper, okay, the distance between them goes on increasing. So these are developed due to expansion of the rock masses as the overlying material is removed, okay, by erosion, and to some extent these joints are developed by temperature changes also. So because of that, the temperature changes. Here you can see there is a batholith of granite, okay, and this up to several kilometers, okay, there is a top weathered portion, and when this weathered portion is removed, okay, so this portion is relieved, okay, that is exposed to the surface of the earth, and as a result there will be a exfoliation, or because of the release of tension, okay. So these rocks, they start splitting into sheet like structures, so that is called as the sheet joint. Here you, in the image, you can see how the rocks has broken, okay, into sheet like structure, so that is called as the sheet joints. Then the next type of joint is mud crack, okay, that is again formed due to tension joints. It is similar to formation of columnar structure, but here this is formed in very fine grained soil, okay, very fine grained rocks, like which are made up of very fine sediments. So these are also the tension joints, which are formed in similar manner as that of the columnar joints, but here the contraction occurs due to drying of mud, whereas in columnar joints, what happens? The contraction occurs due to cooling of the lava, and here it is formed because of the drying of the mud. So as the fine clay or mud, it will dry, it gives rise to the cracks, which are enclosing roughly again polygonal areas. So these cracks, they are wider at the surface, and as you go down, okay, they are wider at the surface, and as you go down, okay, below, they become narrower with the increasing depth. So these are called as the mud cracks. So these are exposed, okay, in dry regions wherein the water evaporates, and the mud which is there, it starts shrinking or contracting, and because of the drying, and that is how the mud cracks are formed. So in this image you can see there are mud cracks, okay, and they are preserved into, they are converted into rock, okay. So this is how the mud cracks are preserved, okay. So mud cracks are found in very fine grained rocks like shale, okay, which is made up of clay. So this is one more type of joint which is formed as a result of drying of the mud, that creates tension, okay, and that is how the joints are formed. Then the one more type of joint, that is called as mural joint. So mural, so these are the three set of joints, They are mutually perpendicular to each other and they are usually developed in igneous rocks like granites, and the spacing between the joints is more or less equal, and because of that the rock will split into cubical blocks, or they are also called as murals. So it is called as the mural joint. So it breaks into cubic blocks. Okay, here you can see in the image cubic blocks. Here also it has broken into cubic blocks. The rock will break into cubic blocks. So it is a set of three set of joints. You can see here. This is the first set of joint, right? Then this is the one more set of joint, okay? And this is the third set of joint, okay? So there are three set of joints which are perpendicular to each other, and that results into formation of cubic blocks. So that is called as the mural joints. So these are the important types of joints which are formed as a result of tensional forces acting on the rocks. Okay, then there are some minor joints like release joint. They are formed when the load from the top is removed. Okay, that numerous fractures are formed at right angle to the axis of compression of the load which is removed. Because of that the compression will take place, and the fractures which are caused by expansion of the specimen when it releases the load. Okay, but because there is no active tension involved in it, they are called as the release joints. Then feather joint, they look like feather. These are usually commonly formed during the faulting. Okay, so along the fault, okay, on either side there will be some parallel cracks which are formed, and they look like feather on the hanging wall or on the foot wall. So they are called as feather joint. So these are the different types of joints which are formed. Now let us discuss the different types of joints in different types of rocks. So joints in igneous, sedimentary and metamorphic rocks. So as I told you, the different types of joints. So we'll see in which type of rock which type of joints are formed. So here in the first image you can see this is from Kolhapur, Maharashtra. Okay, here you can see the columnar structure which is exposed beautifully. So joints in igneous rocks, basalt is a igneous rock, granite is a igneous rock. So in igneous rocks, igneous rocks are jointed to varying degree depending upon the conditions under which the magma has cooled down during the formation of the rock. So the tension joints are developed in igneous rocks due to contraction of the magma or lava. Then columnar tension joints are commonly developed in basalt, which is a volcanic igneous rock, whereas the mural joints, which has a three set of joints, so these type of joints, they are developed in massive deep seated igneous rocks like granites. Okay, then sheet joints are also formed in granite. So these are the different types of joints which are formed. Okay, this is the sheet joint. Okay, so in sedimentary rocks, so in folded sedimentary rock, the tension joints are developed near the axial plane or axial part of the fold, and shear joints are developed in the limbs of the fold, whereas tension joints are formed at the crest, shear joints are formed at the limbs of the fold. So fine grained sedimentary rocks like clay that show presence of mud cracks. Okay, so and these bedding planes, okay, in sedimentary rocks, they act as the joints. Okay, So these bedding planes, bedding joints are common in sedimentary rocks. So this is the mural joints. Okay. So joints in metamorphic rocks, these are sometimes heavily jointed and they are poorly exhibited. In coarse crystalline rocks like gneisses, which is equivalent to granite. So joints which are similar to granite can be observed in the metamorphic equivalent rock like granite. In granite we find the sheet joint. So same in gneiss also we can find the mural joint and the sheet joint. So they are similar to their respective igneous or sedimentary equivalent. Suppose in Badami caves you might have seen there are sandstone which is a sedimentary rock, okay, which has big cracks which are formed. Those are nothing but the joints, and the equivalent metamorphic equivalent of sandstone is quartzite. Even that results into similar joints which are shown by the sandstone, that is the bedding joints. Okay, so vertical joints, they are the common in rocks. Okay, then the next concept which is very very important, that is the engineering consideration. So as a civil engineer, what is the importance of these joints? So the joints and the faults, they are important in engineering, even in mining and quarrying, because they are the planes of weakness. Okay, otherwise the rock will be strong if it is devoid of joints. If the joints are present, the rock will become weaker. So the selection of site for dam and the reservoir, and also the alignment for highway, tunnel through these rocks, they will require very thorough investigation of joints for arriving at a safe and economic design, because there are chances of collapse of the ground in hilly region and all. There, if the rocks are highly jointed, they undergo weathering and there will be landslides. So even in case of dam, reservoir, there will be a silting of reservoir, problem will be there. Then the joints are always to be considered as a source of weakness of the rock and as a pathway for leakage of water through the rocks. So both these properties of joints, they destroy the inherent soundness of the rock to a great extent. Suppose we consider the granite as the strong rock, hard rock, but if that granite is having joints, then it will lose its strength, the inherent soundness of the rock to a great extent will be destroyed. So these joints, they play a very important role. Suppose if you take an example of a dam or a reservoir which is constructed in jointed rocks, then there will be often leakage because the water flows through, or water follows the fractures and seeps around the dam, and this needs a very heavy cost for treatment of the rock. So this rock, the water which is percolating through these cracks, what will happen? It will exert an upward pressure on the dam, so it may harm the dam. Then if the roof or sides of the rocks in case of a tunnel, they are very much fractured, then what will happen? The slippage of the rocks along these fractures, and even there will be a leakage of water that may become troublesome. So in such cases, you have to provide the lining for the tunnel. So then the joints are major cause for the instability of the rock masses in the hilly region. When we construct the roads, many landslides and the slope failure are directly related to the jointed nature of the material. Then the treatment of joint, they may involve the grouting. You can do the grouting to seal down these cracks with a suitable grouting material for increasing the strength of the rocks, or for reducing their permeability, or for achieving both these objectives. So by doing grouting, what we can do, we can increase the strength of the rock, When we seal those cracks, we can increase the strength of the rock and we can reduce the permeability. Permeability is the ability of a rock to transmit the water, right? So if permeability you can reduce, then there will be the reduction in the problem which are related to the water flow in the cracks. So the last point to discuss is about the importance of joints, why these joints are important. So the during mineral exploration in mining industries, these joints play a very important role. Then in granite industries for coring the rock blocks, the joints, if they're present, then the coring becomes easier. Then to find the groundwater flow in hydrogeological aspects, a good permeable layer for aquifer, it acts as a oil and gas reservoir, and also it helps in migration of hydrocarbons. So this groundwater and pollutant within the aquifer or the petroleum in the reservoir and hydrothermal circulation at depth within the bedrock. So these are all the problems which are associated with joints. Then to understand the geology and even the geomorphology of the local area, because the joints, they have a control over the weathering and erosion of the rocks. So they play a very important role. So joints are important to the economic and safe development of the petroleum, the hydrothermal and the groundwater resources, and the subject of intensive research which is relative to development of these resources. So these are the important applications of joints. So as a civil engineer, you must have to study properly before constructing any type of structure. It may be a dam, tunnel or a highway. These joints play a very important role. They may cause they may be harmful during and after the construction. So we have to pay much attention towards these joints. So thank you.